Hare Krishna. Welcome to the narration of those 14 days where we discuss day by day the events on the Kurukshetra war that is the climax of the Mahabharata. Today we discuss day 14. On the 13th day, Abhimanyu was brutally slaughtered by six Kaurava warriors coming together. When Arjuna returned on the 13th day, he could see and sense a deathly silence all around the Pandava camp. There were no celebratory sounds. When he entered into the tent, his worst fears turned out to be true. He had heard during the heat of the war someone saying that Drona had formed the Chakravyuha. And he had known that apart from him only, his son Abhimanyu could penetrate into it, but he couldn't come out. Surely he hadn't been sent in. As Arjuna was thinking like this, and he entered into the tent where all the warriors would assemble before and after the war, his eyes straight went to the place where his son would sit. That throne was empty. While all other thrones were occupied, his heart stopped. He looked up at Yudhishthira and all his brothers. They looked disheveled and devastated. As Arjuna approached Yudhishthira got up from his chariot and with words filled with pain and remorse, Yudhishthira told about the situations by which Abhimanyu had ended up alone and helpless. As Arjuna heard the descriptions of the situations, he fell to the ground in agony. Turning around, he lashed out at everyone verbally. He looked at his brothers and he said, "Are all your weapons just bangles? Could none of you protect my son?" Krishna walked up to Arjuna and put his shoulder around his arm. He said, "O Partha, calamities visit everyone in this world. The wise are characterized by actions that decrease the distress amid calamities, not increase the distress. O Partha, see your brothers are as afflicted as you are by the death of Abhimanyu. Pray don't speak words that hurt them further." As Arjuna continued to hear about the brutality with which Abhimanyu had been slaughtered, his agony gave way to fury, and he resolved to get back at the Kauravas, to set right the brutal wrong they had done. When he heard about how the Pandavas had made a plan to support Abhimanyu and how that plan had been opportunistically thwarted by Jayadrath, Arjuna felt all his rage concentrate on that vile Sindhu king. He was the cause of Abhimanyu's death. Quite often, warriors may find themselves weakened, but they were saved by their allies at that time. To deliberately cut off a warrior from his allies was a malicious act, and that too to this way endanger and trap a 16-year-old lad was the vilest of deeds. Jayadrath deserved to die. Arjuna then and there raised his bow and took a vow. "Tomorrow, before sunset, I will kill Jayadrath. And if I can't, I will enter into fire and end my life." On hearing Arjuna's fearsome vow, the mood in the Pandava camp changed from dread to anticipation. Arjuna, in this mood of fury, driven by this, such a vow would be unstoppable. The day of the Kauravas' great victory and the Pandavas' great loss would be followed by a day of stupendous triumph for the Pandavas. Thinking thus, all the Pandava warriors started blowing their conches in a celebratory roar. On the other side of the battlefield, the Kauravas were celebrating the death of Abhimanyu. And suddenly they heard the Pandavas also celebrating. While they were surprised, trying to figure out what had happened, messengers came to them and said, told them about Arjuna's vow. Jayadrath was panic struck, he said. No one can stop Partha when he's enraged. His face became a mask of terror and he said, "Oh, prince, assure me my protection or otherwise I'm fleeing to the Himalayas to hide in those mountains right away." Duryodhan sensed an opportunity over here. He said, "Oh, Sindhu King, don't worry. Tomorrow, Drona will deploy our entire army to stop Arjuna. Arjuna will never be able to reach you and will be forced to go to the place where his son has gone today. Fear not. Drona will ensure your protection." Drona looked at Duryodhan and Jayadrath. In his mind, he knew that Jayadrath was dead already. He told Jayadrath, "Tomorrow I will arrange my army in such a way that Arjuna will not be able to reach you." While he was saying this, he knew in his mind that Arjuna alone would not be able to reach Jayadrath, but Arjuna was not alone. Arjuna was with Krishna. And the two of them together would not be stopped even by the armies of the gods and the demons combined together. Yet, Drona had a duty. And the next morning, he arranged his army in a formidable formation. When Arjuna came forth to start the battle, to fulfill his vow, he saw that the Kaurava army was spread 20 miles across and almost double deep. The observing sages and celestials from the skies thought this formation will devour the entire earth, what to speak of the Pandava army. Drona arranged for several formidable warriors, Karna, Ashwatthama, Shalya, Krupacharya, Vrishasena, to all personally guard Jayadrath, and Drona said that he would stand at the front of the army to stop Arjuna from advancing. So Krishna told Arjuna, "O Partha, see how Drona has formed the army to foil you. Reaching Jayadrath will be extremely difficult." The previous night, after Arjuna had made that vow, when Krishna and Arjuna were privately together, Krishna chided Arjuna. He said, "O Partha, under the rush of emotions, you made a hasty vow. It will not be possible. It will be very difficult to reach Jayadrath." So Arjuna was confident and almost nonchalant. He said, "O Krishna, I do not understand your anxiety. You know my power and I know your power." And more poignant words have rarely been spoken. A devotee knows the power, the Lord knows the power of the devotee, and the devotee knows the power of the Lord. In this case, when Krishna reiterated his warning, Arjuna and Krishna both remembered the previous night's conversation. They shared a private smile. And as the conches were blown to start the day's fight, Arjuna charged forward. One of Duryodhana's brothers, Durmarshan, came forward. He said, "I will stop Arjuna today." He fought furiously for For a brief while, they fought on. But soon, Arjuna destroyed all the soldiers and warriors supporting Durmarshan. And then he wounded Durmarshan so severely. His armor was destroyed, his weapons were destroyed, his chariot was destroyed, his standard was knocked down. With the next arrow, Arjuna could have killed Durmarshan. But remembering Bhima's vow to kill all the Kaurava brothers, Arjuna spared him. Durmarshan fled. Then, seeing this, Dushasan came forward. Dushasan too fought, but it was just a brief flight, and Dushasan, wounded and battered, fled. No one could stop Arjuna in this mood. And Drona came forward. Arjuna offered his respects to Drona and he said, Oh teacher, oh Acharya, please let me go ahead and fulfill my vow. Dronacharya said that, you will not be able to go without defeating me. As teacher and disciple started fighting with each other, the fight seemed to captivate the whole universe. Neither of them seemed to get the upper hand. It was the early morning. Drona, though old, was still fresh, and he kept thwarting all of Arjuna's attempts to push ahead. Krishna reminded Arjuna, Arjuna, do not go gentle. Although he is your teacher, you have to get past him. You are wasting too much time. Reminded by Krishna's strong, sharp words, Arjuna shot a series of arrows that overwhelmed Drona. And while Drona was stunned by that volley, Krishna shot Arjuna's chariot past Drona. By the time Drona recovered and turned around, he called out, Oh Arjuna, where are you going? Have you become afraid? But Arjuna kept moving rapidly past. Drona shot a series of arrows, told Arjuna to stop him, but Krishna moved Arjuna's chariot so fast as it plowed through the Kaurava ranks that Drona's arrows fell behind. Meanwhile, Drishtaketu turned around, called out a challenge to Drona. And Drona turned back, and Arjuna's rushed through. Then Arjuna was challenged by Krutavarman. Krutavarman was the only, was among the few Yadus who was fighting on the Kurukshetra war. Satyaki was one fighting on the Pandava side. Krutavarman was another who was fighting on the Kaurava side. He had gone with the Narayan Sena. Arjuna and Krutavarman were friends. And they both fought fiercely. Yet Krutavarman matched Arjuna till Krishna reminded him, forget your friendship with him. You don't have any moment to waste. Being reminded thus, again, Arjuna shot a series of arrows so fierce and forceful that Krutavarman was overwhelmed. And before Krutavarman could recover from the attack and the wounds, Arjuna shot past him. He just raced through all the Kaurava warriors one by one by one. Nobody could stop him. The army had seen Arjuna's valor and skill on every day of the Kurukshetra war. But on no day was he ever like this. Arjuna, enraged by the death of his son, was utterly unstoppable. The Kaurava soldiers screamed and fled. Seeing the panic in the army, a powerful Kaurava ally, Shrutayush, challenged Arjuna. They both fought fiercely. Shrutayush was soon outclassed in the archery fight, but he had a mace, which had been given by Varuna. And that could destroy the strongest of enemies. But knowing Shrutayush's wicked tendencies, Varuna, while gifting that mace to him, had warned him, if you use this ever against somebody who is not fighting, who is a non-combatant, this mace will turn around and attack you and destroy you. As Shrutayush charged toward Arjuna, and Arjuna fought back And Shutayu's attacks had been not only countered by Arjuna, but had been baffled by Krishna too. So in the heat of the moment, Shutayush was somehow desperately wanting to score a hit against those who had thwarted him. So when he neared Arjuna's chariot through the storm of arrows that Arjuna was sending toward him, he saw an opportunity to swing that mace at Krishna. As he brought that mace down on Krishna, Varuna's prophetic words turned true. The mace slipped from his hand and went back and hit him and killed him. Then two Kamboja princes, Vinda and Anuvinda, suddenly attack Arjuna as he is charging through. Their combined attack was so forceful that Arjuna was stunned. In fact, their arrows hit Arjuna so severely that Arjuna swooned. Krishna expertly maneuvered Arjuna's chariot out of danger while Arjuna gathered his wits back. Once Arjuna was standing again on his chariot, he bit his lip and glared angrily at these two princes. And shooting a fierce shower of arrows, he decimated their army and then destroyed both of them. Arjuna charged relentlessly, moving through the Kaurava ranks. Seeing his advance from a distance, Duryodhana became alarmed. He begged to Drona, please do something, otherwise Arjuna will destroy our entire army today, all by himself. Drona thought carefully. The Pandavas had planned their strategy well. While Arjuna was blowing through the Kaurava ranks, other Pandava warriors were strategically engaged with other Kaurava heroes. And he didn't want to send ahead any of the Kaurava heroes who were deputed to defend Jayadrath. So he told Duryodhan, there is no one at present who can stop Arjuna. I do not want to leave Jayadrath, lest Arjuna slip through and fulfill his vow before I can stop him. The only person who is there now is you, O Prince. Duryodhana was taken aback. He said, I might be able to defeat Indra, but I cannot defeat Indra's son when he's in this mood. So Drona nodded and he said, I will not offer you, O Prince, as a sacrificial lamb to Arjuna when he's in this mood, but I can empower you. I have an armor that is impenetrable. It is a mystical armor and I will put that on you. Normally, I would not risk you, but this is an emergency. With this armor, even Arjuna's Gandiva won't be able to injure you. Hearing this, Duryodhana felt inflated and he, after Drona had put on that mystical armor around him by chanting mantras, he charged toward where Arjuna was rampaging through his forces. And he challenged Arjuna. Now, just before this, Arjuna actually had done something even more astonishing. Krishna had told that, Arjuna, our horses have become tired. Such has been the force of the fight and the exertion in racing so far, so fast. They need rest, they need water, they need grass. So Arjuna had jumped off the chariot and shot some mystic arrows and created a lake along with water and grass. And Krishna had taken the horses there. Bravo, well done, Krishna told Arjuna. Seeing Arjuna chariotless, the Kauravas sensed an opportunity and charged toward him. But Arjuna, moving round and round in circle, shooting arrows continuously, stopped all of them. Those Kauravas who tried to charge toward him were stopped as if by a wall of arrows. And after resting and feeding the horses, Krishna came back. Arjuna leapt onto the chariot and both of them had continued. Now Arjuna was fresh and Arjuna's horses were fresh and energized. as he was breaking through the Kaurava ranks when Duryodhan came. So initially Krishna and Arjuna were both surprised, and the Kaurava soldiers were alarmed to see Duryodhana challenging Arjuna. But when Arjuna shot his arrows and none of them had any effect, the Kaurava warriors supporting Duryodhana became jubilant. Bravo, bravo! They started cheering him. Krishna again chided Arjuna. This is not the time to lose touch. What is happening? Your arrows, which could penetrate even the earth, are falling harmlessly on hitting Duryodhana. Arjuna thought carefully and he said, I know what is happening. Drona has given his impenetrable armor to him. But I know what to do. He knew that that armor covered the entire body but not the tips of the fingers. So while Duryodhana was proudly milking in all the praise, he said, oh Partha, is that your best? Shoot all your arrows and then I will destroy you and your arrogance. Because he was arrogant, and he was literally living in on not borrowed plumes but borrowed armor. Arjuna smiled. Aiming carefully, he shot arrows rapidly at all the fingertips of Arjuna, of Duryodhana. Duryodhana shrieked in pain and dropped his bow and arrow. And seeing him writhing and crying like that, Krishna and Arjuna laughed and charged past him. And as Arjuna went deeper and deeper into the Kaurava rank, at the base, Yudhishthira started becoming anxious. Yesterday, Abhimanyu had been trapped in the Kaurava ranks. What if Arjuna was trapped today? He turned around to Satyaki, who was a student of Arjuna, and requested him, please go and help your teacher today. Satyaki, after ensuring that there were other warriors to protect Yudhishthira, raced in. He saw the trail of destruction that Arjuna had brought while charging through the Kaurava ranks, and he followed through. And after Satyaki had disappeared deep into the Kaurava ranks, Yudhishthira felt further anxiety. Satyaki was not much older than Abhimanyu. He turned toward Bhima and he said, what if Satyaki is trapped? Please, O Bhima, go ahead and go into the Kaurava ranks and help Satyaki and your brother gladly. While Bhima had been engaging with some warriors on the outer rims of the war, he was itching to be in the thick of action. He jumped at the opportunity that Yudhishthira had provided. And he mowed through the Kaurava ranks. And with just a few hours remaining for the sunset, he reached Arjuna. Satyaki was already with him. And reaching Arjuna, he blew his conch. His conch was so loud and so resonant that the sound reached back to Yudhishthir, thereby reassuring him that he was safe and he had reached Arjuna. And Arjuna welcomed Bhima and he said that with you and Satyaki assisting me, I don't think the Kauravas have a chance. Yet they knew that a grim task lay ahead. They were now very close to Jayadrath. There was a last line of defense which was there. Karna came forward. And as Karna charged toward Arjuna, Bhima challenged him. And as Arjuna left Karna aside, he knew that they had placed a huge burden on Bhima. Karna was no mediocre warrior. Yet Arjuna had more pressing concerns. Arjuna pressed on with great fury. Bhima, while keeping Karna engaged, also started destroying the warriors supporting him. He killed one after another several of Duryodhana's brothers. As Duryodhana watched on, in horror he saw that Bhima had killed 20 of his brothers. Arjuna was unstoppable. Satyaki was single-handedly destroying the Trigartha army. He thought, Are these all divinely aided? How is it possible that we can't stop them? As he was panicking, he looked at the sun. The sun was so close to the horizon. Just a short while. Surely, if we all come together, we will be able to stop Arjuna. And he ordered all his warriors to simultaneously attack Arjuna. Arjuna could now see Jayadrath's chariot with its standard on top of it. And yet, suddenly, he found himself attacked by arrows from all sides. It was like a dark cloud of arrows that had descended around him, leaving him with practically no sight. Arjuna's bow was stretched almost in a circle as he was discharging arrows continuously. But the sheer volume of the attack was such that Arjuna could barely move ahead. So close, and yet so far. Arjuna started despairing, and Krishna noticed his friend's predicament. Using his mystic powers, Krishna summoned the Sudarshan Chakra. That was his mystical weapon, and as it appeared on his finger, he discharged it. And the Sudarshan Chakra flew into the sky and covered the sun. As the sun disappeared, the Kaurava warriors started celebrating. Arjuna is dead. And as they started thumping their chests and patting each other on the back, Jayadrath emerged, jeering at Arjuna. "Should I light your sacrificial pyre?" That seemed his expression. Arjuna lowered his bow in consternation. Krishna, in an urgent voice, told him, "There is still time, Arjuna. Place the Brahmastra on your bow," and pointed to Jayadrath's head. Arjuna knew that Krishna must be having a plan. This was not the time to ask any questions. He promptly did as he was told. Krishna told him, "Jayadrath's father has given him a benediction that anybody who causes Jayadrath's head to fall on the ground will himself have his head smash into a thousand, crack into a thousand pieces. Rudakshatra, Jayadrath's father, is performing austerities in the Simanthpachak Mountains, which are some distance away from it. Shoot the Brahmastra and knock off Jayadrath's head in such a way that head flies through the air and falls on Rudakshatra's lap." As Arjuna brought his bow forward to shoot Jayadrath, Krishna removed the Sudarshan Chakra. The last few rays of the sun still remained. And while the Kauravas watched, bewildered, Arjuna's arrow sailed through the sky right in front of their eyes. And before Jayadrath could do anything to either defend or dodge, the arrow came with blinding speed and lopped off his head and flew high into the sky. Rudakshatra was meditating in the hills, and suddenly he felt something fall on his lap. He saw a bloody skull. In shock, he got up and knocked it down. And as that head fell on the ground, by the benediction that he had sought, his own head cracked into pieces. On the battlefield, as Jayadrath's headless body crashed to the ground, the Pandavas, Krishna and Arjuna, embraced each other. The Kauravas lamented, and Arjuna had achieved a stupendous victory. This was a race against time, and Arjuna had won it by his effort and Krishna's grace. This story illustrates how when we do our best, exerting to our fullest effort, we can leave the rest to the Lord. That if we do all that we can, God will do what we can't. When Arjuna took a vow, he did not ask that Krishna fulfill that vow for him. When we do something worthwhile, something virtuous, something ambitious, we can't expect God to make all the arrangements and make the road easy for us. We need to exert, we need to use all the abilities and energies and resources that we have been given by God. And when we do our best, if still our best falls short, as it often may in this world, where everything can be incredibly challenging, especially everything worthwhile or wonderful, at that time, whatever we fall short of, God will compensate. That is the lesson that is dramatically illustrated by Arjuna's conquest over Jayadrath. We do our best, and then what if we do our best? If we do all that we can, God will do or whatever we can't. Thank you. Hare Krishna.